Saudi Arabia's leaders congratulate Philippine President-elect Ferdinand Marcos Jr. on his election win. Saudi's foreign ministry says the country's king and crown prince have expressed their best felicitations to Marcos through a diplomatic cable. The Saudi royals were said to have wished success for Marcos and further progress, prosperity, and development for the Philippines. The king and crown prince are the latest foreign leaders to greet Marcos following his May 9th poll victory. Among those who earlier congratulated him are the presidents of the U.S., China, and Russia. China rejects the Philippines' protests against its unilateral imposition of an annual fishing ban in the South China Sea. China's foreign ministry insists the summer moratorium is a normal measure to conserve resources in waters under China's jurisdiction. It adds the move fulfills its obligations under international law, including the UN Conventions on the Law of the Sea. Manila's Foreign Affairs Department filed a diplomatic protest against the ban Thursday as it extended to areas in the West Philippine Sea, over which the Philippines has sovereign rights. Meanwhile, the Philippine Coast Guard has committed to accompanying and monitoring Filipino fishermen in the West Philippine Sea, insisting it is not covered by the moratorium. Amid the dispute, Chinese Ambassador Huang Xilian paid a courtesy call on PCG Commandant Admiral Artemio Abu Thursday. Abu says the visit sought to review friendly exchanges and cooperation between the PCG and the Chinese Coast Guard. Philippine President-elect Ferdinand Bongbong Marcos Jr. set to take his oath of office at the National Museum in Manila. The historic building is said to be a sentimental favorite of the country's incoming 17th president, Katrina Domingo reports.
The facade of the National Museum is undergoing some changes as the historic building is being prepared to host the inauguration of President-elect Ferdinand Marcos Jr. as the 17th president of the Philippines. Incoming Presidential Management Staff Chief Zenaida Angping says the inaugural committee held an ocular inspection recently and found the centuries-old landmark suitable for Marcos's oath-taking. The Department of Public Works and Highways is in charge of putting up temporary bleachers where VIP guests will be seated. But officials in charge of the undertaking say that the initial plan may still change in the coming days, depending on the call of Marcos and the Presidential Security Group.
We have security considerations kasi so whatever information that we have to impart must take into consideration the safety of the people involved and the president-elect. That's why medyo yung ibang mga detalye, we definitely still don't know what they are.
The National Museum building was once known as the Old Legislative Building, where inaugurations of past presidents took place, particularly President Manuel L. Quezon in 1935, Jose P. Laurel in 1943, and Manuel Rojas in 1946. It also housed the two branches of Congress in the past, which is why Marcos Jr. has fond memories of the building.
So they also looked at the National Museum, also another sentimental favorite kasi dating ang naaalala yata ni President-elect na sinusundo at hinahatid ang father niya doon at minsan kasama siya sa paghatid-sundo.
Angeles says they have yet to finalize the number of guests who will attend the inauguration ceremony on June 30. Information about the event's theme, menu, budget, and program have also yet to be released. So far, the only thing Angeles can guarantee is that guests will be required to come in formal Filipiniana attire. Katrina Domingo, ABS-CBN News.
Tighter police security in the Philippines' Mindanao region ahead of the June 19th inauguration of Vice President-elect Sara Duterte. Police are on heightened alert after a blast that killed one person on a bus in Coronadal City, South Cotabato. President Duterte's daughter is set to take her oath along a street near the Davao City Hall, where she served as mayor.
Kami po ay nakikiusap po sa ating pong mga kababayan, lalong-lalo na po yung gustong dumalaw, be it by land, by air, or by sea. Na sisiguraduhin po natin na mas magiging maigpit ang pagpapatupad po ng ating security measures sa area, no? Lalong-lalo na sa papasok sa area. So kung pumunta po kayo sa inauguration area, we advise that you come at least 2 hours earlier para po mas mapadali nating malusutan yung mga checkpoints, mapapaaga po tayo.
Amid the heightened security, law enforcers killed a suspected bomber and arrested another in Malang, Cotabato on Tuesday. The suspects are believed to be members of extremist group Daula Islamia Maguindanao. The Philippine Drug Enforcement Agency destroys more than 14 billion pesos worth of illegal drugs. Most of the illegal narcotics were shabu seized in Infanta, Quezon last April. The drugs were presented by PIDEA in Cavite, where they are burned. In the meantime, PIDEA Director General Wilkins Villanueva says over 25,000 villages nationwide are now considered drug-free. Acting Philippine National Police Chief Vicente Danao, for his part, says only 6,000 people died in legitimate anti-drug operations. But data analyzed by the ABS-CBN Investigative and Research Group showed a total of 7,009 drug-related deaths were reported in the past 6 years of the Duterte administration. Human rights groups, meanwhile, say the death toll is much higher.
The Vice President-elect, meanwhile, says she will support the continuation of the campaign against illegal drugs. In a message during a program of the Philippine Drug Enforcement Agency, Duterte Carpio said she is confident the agency will continue to perform its mandate well. She also hopes PIDEA will help promote a safer environment for everyone through various campaigns against drug abuse. The drug war is one of the major programs of the Vice President-elect's father, but it's been riddled with controversies right from the beginning, including alleged extrajudicial killings.